wasted love, but I still have some more. The bargain store is open, come inside.
Goodness gracious, we've got so many of you dialing in from all over Australia. It's incredibly exciting seeing you all coming through. We're now going to get started. That little musical introduction, I'm sure you all know, is Dolly, and there is a very good reason for it. Obviously, it's Bargain Store. At Gareth Sotrell, we obviously love a bargain. It's a very appropriate song for us. But just a little fact you may not know about the amazing Sally, who's our presenter today, is she's also a really big country fan. So it was chosen with her in mind, too. So just a little bit about today. So today is the very first trail tutorial that Gareth Sotrell has ever hosted. We're incredibly excited that each of you from across the country, about 780 odd people from across Australia, registered to be part of today, and it's a sold out session. So a huge welcome and thank you for being part of the first event. It's a series of events we're going to be running in the next month that are all about secondhand styling and fashion and learning to live with less. So you'll see coming up, we've got another one later this month with the amazing Erin Lewis Fitzgerald, or Elf, and Christina, who I believe is on the line with us today, all about mending and fixing your clothes. And then later on in November, we've got a fantastic session with two really well-known sustainable stylists teaching you all about the art of secondhand shopping and styling. So those events are coming up. Put them in your diary. We'd love to welcome you along to those events too. For those of you that don't know us, we are garage sale trail, and we organise Australia's biggest weekend of garage sales every single year. So that sees around 400,000 Australians get involved in a big weekend of garage sales. This year it's happening on the 21st and the 22nd of November, and it's all about being a COVID recovery edition. It's about helping people make or save some money by buying or selling secondhand this year. So we'd encourage you all to find out more about it by going to our website, and hopefully after this session you'll be really inspired, I'm sure you will, to go and get decluttering, and then you'll be ready to sell some clothes on the Gareth Sotrell this November. So Gareth Sotrell and the session today is made possible thanks to some amazing partners that we're very lucky to have, and I just wanted to do a small shout out and send some big love to all of the local councils around Australia, including, I'm sure, many of the local councils that you live in, who make the program possible, as well as the ACT government, the New South Wales EPA, and the state government in WA as well. So it's a big thank you to them for enabling us to put on these events. So I'm sure you're ready now to begin and hear from our extra special guest today, Sally Flower. So today's session is the ultimate wardrobe declutter. It's all about learning to uncover some hidden gems in your wardrobe and get some really top tips from Sally on how to reorganize and declutter your wardrobe. Sally's going to talk for about 25 minutes, half an hour. We've left lots of time for questions. So we really encourage you to get on the chat box. Anything you're burning to ask Sally, make sure you jot it down, and I will be your voice at the end of the session so that we can answer any questions that are particularly relevant to you and to your situation. A little bit about Sally, and she'll provide you with some background too. Sally has been an ambassador of Gareth Sotrell for 2 years. We are incredibly proud to work with her. She's an absolutely amazing superwoman. She was the first ever Australian to be trained under Marie Kondo. And she's also a mindfulness coach, a wellness coach. She's a yogi. There's nothing this lady can't do. So prepare to be very inspired, to feel energized and really motivated to get organizing. Over to you, Sally.
Wow, what an introduction. Thank you so much, Barb. And you've got the claps online, I love that. thank you all so much for coming. I'm super excited to be here. Garage Sale Trail is such an awesome event, and to be the first cab off the rank is very exciting. I am gonna share my screen with you because I have some really cool things I want you to see. So today we're going to be going through consumption. We're going to give you a bit of background on consumption and the idea of how we have so much stuff. We're going to be talking about how to declutter sustainably. In particular, we're going to talk about those hidden gems in your back of your wardrobes that you may not know about, and finding love for your stuff that you already have, or falling back in love with things that you already have. We're going to do the all-exciting KonMari folding demo. I'm going to be doing T-shirts, and I've also got some socks and undies here. So if you want to make and join along with me, go and grab those pieces now, and we'll be folding together a little bit later on. And then we'll be doing how to become a conscious consumer, which is really important. And then we will be talking, doing all the Q&A. So heaps of time for questions, so make sure you do pop them all in there. So a little bit about me. I am the founder of Home Sanctuary, and essentially my job at Home Sanctuary is to help people to lead nurturing lives in meaningful homes with less. And I've decluttered about 60 to 80 homes all over Australia. Now that might not sound like a lot, but if you think about how long it just takes you to clean a drawer in your kitchen, you would realise that doing quite a few homes is a big undertaking. And I've reached hundreds more through workshops and talks like this one, and then thousands more through radio and TV and advertising, that kind of thing, which has been awesome. But I never intended on being a professional organizer or a home wellness coach, which is what I call myself now. I spent my last 8 years in corporate finance, but my love for the environment and my passion for simple living really shone through so often. And I was living in New York City when I finally got a hold of the very famous Marie Kondo's book, The Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up. You couldn't actually get it in the States at that time. And I've always been a very organized person, and maybe for some of you out there as well, the book really spoke to me. And in some kind of a weird, quirky, fun way, Marie Kondo made it okay for me to love organizing and to feel good about that. And I really thank her for that. But it kind of got me thinking as I was reading this book. In New York City, people pay other people to wrap their Christmas presents. They pay other people to collect their laundry. I thought maybe this tidy consulting thing is a reality. So I did some Googling, and 3 weeks later, I became the first Aussie to have undergone an intensive Japanese organizing training program. And since then, it's just kind of snowballed. Once I finished the training in 2015, and then when I came back to Australia, people started reaching out to me to ask me to organise their wardrobes, and it was this surreal moment really where people were paying me to kind of go through their things, which was really what I loved. It was really cool. And then all of a sudden people started going crazy on social media for pictures of perfectly folded clothing, and it just kind of got bigger. But for me, I think the hardest part about professional organizing is this unspoken reality of waste. And it really wasn't until Marie's Netflix series came out that the community started talking up about it, saying that this idea of going through all our stuff creates a lot of waste. But before, I'd actually had a turning point before then. It was very early on when I was organizing, and I would go into a family's home, and it was really, really clear to me that the only way to make the home really livable and harmonious and happy was to just get rid of 100 kilograms of stuff. And this is so common for so many of us Australians. And I really realized that to make us happy, the environment was going to have to take a hit. And I had this constant conflict because I'm such a big advocate for mindful living and loving your surroundings, living in a calm space, but I equally as much love the environment. And I was encouraging and helping these people create waste. And then I would go home and I'd jump on my social media, and other professional organizers around the world and other homeowners doing the same thing were boasting or advertising that they had just thrown all of these garbage bags away. And for me, I thought, this is just, something is not going right. And I know the KonMari team do it as well. And that's really why I've made Home Sanctuary really this hub of mindful living, because the fact that we have so much stuff and then there's other people living in poverty in the world, something is clearly not working. And I've really made this big push for Home Sanctuary to be a place for those of us in a wealthy country like Australia can learn how to live in a way that's not going to create as much waste, and still live a happy and healthy, fulfilling life. So I've taken a break from corporate life, and I'm now studying climate change and sustainable leadership at Melbourne University, because I'm always looking for ways to bring mindfulness into the home and to do it with a way that you love the environment. So today, if there is anything that you see through the slideshow, I really just want you to shout it out. If there's anything that I've learned from this US election, it's that we need to talk about stuff. We need to get it out there. So if you do see anything you love, shout out to your council, shout out to your mates. Just if it's something that you feel is important to you, please share it with the world. So let's just start by talking a bit about consumption. And I'm very aware that we all dialed in today to talk about decluttering, and we will, I very much promise you that. But the key reason we've really found ourselves in this predicament is this consumption habit. But more accurately, it's that non-essential consumption. It's those items that we don't have to have, or it's the duplicates, it's the updates, the replacements, the new pieces that we don't necessarily have to have. And in Australia, we have what social scientists call an affluent economy or a growth economy, which essentially means that we measure our nation's success based on consumption. So our GDP is our key measure of economic success. And we are hearing a lot about this at the moment, so I think it's cool that we talk about it. So this economic success measure is calculated by adding up what everything's spent, by how much we consumed. So when we're going really well, it means we're consuming a lot. And one political party compares to the other by saying, we raised the GDP, which really means we made Australians buy more. And the one thing that GDP always misses is the waste. It never calculates in how much waste we've made. In fact, under this calculation, when we make waste, it's a success. Because waste needs more people to remove it, more landfills to be dug, more energy to move the transport around, more people to advertise and pick up waste, and it's calculated as a success. And I'm not saying this because I just wanted to cause disrupt to start off our talk. I'm talking about it because it's natural that we found ourselves in this predicament. It's natural that we have so much stuff around us because for so long we've treated consuming as a positive thing. But GDP aside, there are multiple studies to show that a minimalist, materialistic lifestyle is just not good for our well-being. When we start to seek satisfaction through things, and we tend to lose that connection to our authentic self, and especially with advertising now, it's almost everywhere. For those of you who watch The Social Dilemma, you'll hear what I'm talking about. It's kind of really hard for us to understand where that authentic self is. And when we live materialistic lives, it can really move us away from that. It's also really, really tiring. This constant idea of working to make money, to buy something to make us feel good. Let's just say it's a new car. You're saving and saving and saving to buy a new car. It's awesome for a while. But then you either get a job promotion or you save more and you want a new car. So then you work and work and work to buy that. And what we've seen, especially in a wealthy economies like Australia, is people are more and more buying things rather than buying time off. So we're working harder to consume more rather than just working to live lives and still enjoy leisure. And for me, that's a really big factor because pretty soon we start consuming so much because we feel good, and then our homes can get full up and look like this. And then all that time we spent working to buy stuff, we now have to take time off to declutter the stuff that we have. It's kind of really crazy when I think about it like this. And I know that this is the extreme. I definitely know that not all of us have homes where there's so much stuff that we need to take time off to declutter, but it is a reality for so many of us. I think the other thing we need to think about is consuming products takes resources at every step in the life cycle. Now, you may not always think about this, say, when you're buying a t-shirt or a new pair of shoes, but resources, it's not just about the waste. It's about the material extraction is taken from each step. So the processing, the manufacturing, and the assembly. And each step we take, water, energy, raw material inputs like cotton and linen and chemicals and plastic, and then these resources are used up. And when we start to take these things out of the earth or grow them in monocultures like cotton, they really start to disrupt the natural state of the planet. So then we get to a stage where we start to be consuming, we start to be consuming more water than is falling from the sky. We start to cut down more trees than we're growing. We start to create large amounts of pollution due to greenhouse gases going into our atmosphere, which are causing global warming. We start to produce so much landfill that we're having to make more space. We start to destroy natural habitats for our environment. And really, I mean, you guys know this. I don't need to badger on about it. We're all aware of it. And I think that the hardest part of it is that when we look at it as an Australian, is that we are actually consuming 5.2 worlds. So we're consuming so many resources as a global, as a whole world, we're consuming 1.7 worlds, but Australia, we're consuming 5.2. And sometimes I find this really hard to understand because we don't always see the direct facts effects in Australia. And I know that I definitely thought this when I started studying the way that we're buying, because we have relatively clean air, we've got green parks, we have koalas and kangaroos jumping around, we go away for the weekend. So why is it that we actually are consuming so much more than everyone else? And I think that there really are three key reasons. The first reason is that we have a lot of space per person. So we can kind of spread out a lot. We don't have the same problems that they have in, say, Singapore, right? We can spread it out a bit. We can buy more storage cages or get that extra room to put the stuff in and not even think about it. Secondly, the damage is really made in other developing neighbouring nations. So a lot of our products that we consume in Australia are produced in places like India or in China, where they use their resources, they do the pollution, they use their waterways, and then they ship it to us. And then we get the end product and they get the pollution. And this, as someone who I really want to make sure everyone in the world is living equally, this is crazy. The fact that every product that I buy, the pollution from this product is being absorbed by another country and other people, is really disheartening. So for me, this is a big thing. For those of you interested, there's a movie called River Blue. There's a picture of it on the screen now. And that's a whole documentary on textile waste and the damaging effects it has in developing economies. And lastly, in Australia, we throw things away and someone else takes care of it. We put it out on the front of our house and it just goes away. And for those of you who have traveled to, say, Cambodia or Thailand or Bali, you'd know that if you put a piece of paper in the waste paper basket, there's a potential likelihood that it's going to end up in the ocean, right? Because they don't have the same kind of resources to move waste away. Whereas in Australia, we do. So we don't even have to think about it. But I think the hardest part with consumption is that there are some really good parts about it. And that's what makes it even so much more confusing when we start to think about it, is that it's a way that we socialize, that we connect, and we show love to our friends and family. It's also a way to express ourselves, particularly with clothing. It also fosters creativity, and it builds identity. But what I want to argue is that we can actually get all of these good things by limiting the amount of damage that we're making. And I also want to note that there is awesome research to show that there are over 200 million people around the world who think like us. Call you like conscious community, or downshifters, or simplicity seekers, whatever you want to call us, there are millions of us around the world. And I believe that as a conscious collective, we can make this way of thinking start to be the new normal. So what are the healthy decluttering habits? And when I was making this slide, I thought, why do I want to put this photo in here? And it's because so often we see downsizing or having less as not really classy, but I want to kind of say that you don't have to have anything less happiness-wise. You can still live a glamorous life with less. And I think I just wanted to kind of talk about that as well, because we don't always talk about that either. You don't have to be a hippie living in a hut. So how do you declutter sustainably? The first thing I really want us to do is know the facts. So Australia consumes 250,000 tons of donated items going to landfill annually. So that picture there with all the clothes bagged up, they're bagged up for landfill. Between $5 and $6 million is spent on waste collection and disposal annually. And we send 6,000 kilograms of textile waste every 10 minutes to landfill. So this is really important when we start to declutter and we're thinking about donating. It's important to remember in the back of our mind that a lot of what we donate doesn't get sold. It goes into to waste. The other thing is that charity stores are volunteer-led. And I like to always have this thought process of think of Judy, or think of an older person in your community who you love and cherish, and imagine them going through your donated items. So it's really important that we send things that are clean, that they're folded, that they're presented nicely and not in a black garbage bag that you've taken a photo of to be like, yeah, I'm decluttering. That you really then also ask yourself, would someone I love buy this? And so I'm not saying don't donate. Please definitely donate to these charities, but just think about what you're donating. My mum volunteers in a charity store and she tells horror stories of people just taking clothes off their backs and just putting it in a bag, not cleaned, washed or folded. And then she and the other volunteers have to go through it. So it's really important that we think about the people who are doing the extra hard work for us to make sure our products get another lifetime. It's also not just the waste thing. Like we mentioned earlier with the resources, a lot of fabrics have a lot of water in them in particular. So a t-shirt is over 2,700 litres of water. Jeans are double that. There's 7,000 kilograms of water. So that's enough drinking water for 2.5 years for a t-shirt. So it's important to think like that. And this is also important when we're going and buying new things that we remember that it's not just the fabric, it's everything else that went into it. Okay, so now that we're all feeling a bit sad, a bit downtrodden, let's talk about how we can keep on going now that we know the facts. Knowing the facts is empowering. We have to know them if you want to keep going. The first thing I want you to do when you're taking on a declutter is you have to declutter in a positive mindset. Never do it when you're tired, when you're mad, frustrated, or otherwise. Because that is what I call the danger zone. When you're just surrounded by stuff and you start throwing things away because you're looking for some joy. And that is not the way to declutter responsibly. You have to be doing it in a positive mindset. Oops. Second, you really want to take time to make your why. Now, this is really important. So you want to be thinking to yourself, asking yourself, why do I want to get organized? What made me sign up to this tutorial today? How do I want my home to feel and function? What are the benefits of me getting organized? And I want it to be really emotive. Try and go deeper than I want to be organized. Make it, I want to be organized so I have more time with my friends and family. So I'm not so stressed and I can spend more time exercising so that I can have people over easily, so that I can come home and relax. I don't spend my weekends looking for stuff so I can save money. Something really emotive, and that is going to be your driver to keep you going when it starts to get a bit tough. And this is what I do with my clients. I really work with them at the start to kind of hone this out. And then about, 3 days into decluttering, I come back to that fact. Why are we doing this? And they're like, oh yes, that's right. And then we can keep on going. The fourth step is that I really want you to focus on joy. Now, of course, this is a KonMari method thing. You really want to be only keeping items in your wardrobe that make you feel good, that are in line with your mantra, and that really kind of you enjoy wearing, you feel confident, you feel your best self, and they represent who you are today. We don't want to have a wardrobe full of who I used to be. We want to think about who I am today and who I'm working towards to be. So I really encourage you to kind of focus on the joy and not to be influenced by others. Now, this is a big thing. You definitely don't want to start decluttering your wardrobe and then going into your friend or your partner and saying, what do you think? Should I keep this? The idea, you really want to be making those decisions yourself. You don't want their joy to be influencing yours. This is all about a self-driven process. It needs to be how your wardrobe feels. It's a curated collection of items to make you feel good. It has to represent you. You also want to avoid advertising and social norms. So anything that's in fashion, is it really in fashion for you, or is it just in fashion in the magazines? What is actually, you know, what do you wear that makes you feel good? Then I really want us to make sure that we're cultivating an eco mindset as we go through the decluttering process. So you really want to be celebrating space and clarity rather than just celebrating throwing away. So you never want to glorify the amount of stuff that you've discarded. You really want to focus and congratulate yourself on how much space you've made in your wardrobe, how your new wardrobe makes you feel. And that's going to be the most responsible way for you to do a wardrobe declutter. Uncovering hidden gems. So this is a KonMari technique. I want you to take a really, really good look at what you have in your wardrobe. And the only way to do that is I want you to take it all out. I want you to clear some schedule on your diary, clear some space on your bed, and take everything out of your wardrobe and have a good look at it. Now, there are some organizers who will then encourage you to wash down the inside of your wardrobe and give it a really good clean and a vacuum. Go out, take a walk, have a glass of water, and then come back and start decluttering. It's so, so easy to flick through the wardrobe like this, like, yes. I don't want you to do that. I want you to take it all out. It's going to be a really great way for you to get a shock factor of the amount of stuff that you have, and it's going to force you to look at every single piece before you put it back in the wardrobe. It's too easy to flip past it otherwise. And then when you are going to start making the decision, you really want to be making your decisions or your decluttering in categories. So this can be everything I wear in the top of my body, everything I wear in the bottom of my body, everything I wear on like outside, like an outerwear, shoes together, accessories together, and so forth. So here is the only caveat to not wanting to take everything out of your wardrobe. If you don't have enough time, so if you only have, say, an hour or so, then just do one category, but make sure you take it all out. So let's just say this afternoon you decide that you want to do your shoes. You need to take all the shoes out from everywhere around your home, bring them into one big pile, and then decide on what not to keep and what to keep using your joy and your newfound eco-conscious mind and your mantra of why you're decluttering. And then the next day you would do just your t-shirts. So you really have to do things in categories. Now, the reason we do this is it's much, much easier for us to ask our brains to make decisions on a like, on a similar kind of object. It's too much for us to ask our brain to make multiple decisions on different types of things, like a book and a pen and a hat and then a shoe and then a handbag. It's too much. We only have a limited amount of decisions that we make in one day. So for the same reason that Barack Obama always wore a blue tie and Steve Jobs always wore a black t-shirt and jeans, they did not want to waste decisions on what to wear. They had very important jobs to do, and so do you. You need to make sure that you're decluttering and using all of your decisions well, so you must do it in categories. Then I wanted to think about your response to fashion. I've got that on the screen. Sorry, I'm rolling up here. It needs to be, it's not about fashion versus I don't feel good in it. So when you're looking at your clothes, don't say to yourself, oh, this isn't in fashion anymore, I shouldn't have it. It should really be, I don't feel good in this anymore, I don't want it. This doesn't fit me well anymore, I don't want it. This is too young for me, or I don't like this color, or this fabric isn't nice on my skin. They're the kind of questions to be asking yourself. I really encourage you not to focus on fashion as much as you can. And then I want you to fall in love again with those pieces that you found that you haven't seen in years because you've now emptied out your wardrobe, and see your wardrobe through new conscious consuming eyes. And you want to upcycle, maybe you want to repair them a little bit, and you can even hide it. Now, this is a technique that the minimalist Courtney Carver does. She will encourage you to box up your items that you're unsure about, or box up items that you know that you do love sometimes but not sure about right now. Don't look at it for a while. Forget about it and then bring it back out. Put a reminder in your phone. Bring it back out and then see how you feel about it. That can sometimes give you a little bit more clarity. The other option is trying a capsule wardrobe. And it kind of is, the picture I've got there is like a hanging of minimalistic clothes on a hanger. And the capsule wardrobe is just a certain amount of items that you use in your wardrobe for 3 months and then you swap it over. So if you're really finding that your wardrobe is overwhelming, a capsule wardrobe is a great way to really hone in on what you love wearing and what's really good for you. Okay, let's do some folding. Now, the key reason we do folding is so that we can see what we have, we know what we have, and that you use it. So let's remember, that is why we do our folding in the KonMari method. Okay, so get out your t-shirt or just follow along. So with t-shirts, if they have a pattern on the front of them, you want to be folding face down, but if they don't, it doesn't matter so much. I'm going to move my camera so you can see. So you place it flat face down, if it's got a, and then you really want to flatten out the wrinkles. And in the KonMari method, we say, thank you, I love this t-shirt, so soft and cuddly. And you really, you know, give a bit of joy back to your t-shirt. But yeah, you then want to be folding along the collar line. So you're really folding in three. So you go all the way over to the collar line, and then you bring that first, this other piece of fabric, all the way over to line up with the first. Then you fold the sleeve in, and then you go from bottom to top, then you fold it probably in thirds again, and there, and then it should stand up. Ta-da! Now I know that it's kind of, when you start off folding on a flat surface like this can take a while, but I promise it gets so much easier. I'm gonna do it with a bigger t-shirt, we'll do it again. So you face down, and you wanna be folding into the collar line. Take one piece of fabric all the way over. And this is key. The first piece of fabric needs to go all the way over and line up. So you've got three pieces of fabric folded. Fold the sleeve back in. Smooth it down. Thank you so much. Cuddly t-shirt. About three is a drinking water. And then you fold it in half. Smooth it down. Half in half again. So the reason we fold like this is it just makes so much more space in your wardrobe. And I'll share some pictures with you later, but it really enables you to kind of put them in a drawer so they all stand up like so. And when you can take one out without disrupting the other. If you put t-shirts in a wardrobe like standing on top of each other, when you take one out, all the others will fold, or you'll always just use the one on top. When you fold vertically, it's encouraging you to use your whole wardrobe. And then that's the best way to go, really. Now, I think I have time. I'm just gonna quickly do some undies. Because, you know, folding undies is a great thing to do in lockdown if you are in Melbourne. Folding face down, bottom to top, half and in half, and then you fold in half again. Do it, I'll do one more. Face down, bottom to top, half and in half, half again. There are so many YouTube videos on this. I have videos on my website. Social media has them. It's really fun. But I promise if you don't start folding your clothes like this, nothing is gonna happen to you. You're still gonna live a happy and healthy life. It's just fun. And it really is a great way to see your wardrobe, and it really feels beautiful. So I'll show you some photos. I'm assuming that we have some questions that I'll be able to answer later on about those. I'll show you what it looks like when you do start folding like this. See here, I'm gonna get my little pointer out, sometimes that works. See here, we have, I folded all the t-shirts standing up like so. And then these are jeans, the same thing you can work with jeans. And it's just a way that you get so much more in your wardrobe this way. If you're a diehard KonMari lover, you'll start folding your socks rolled rather than in balls. So here is a picture of my partner's sock collection. He loves them, so he has him, he's all folded like that. And they just look so fun. They just make a wardrobe just feel so bright and happy. That's why I love folding them like this. It's like going into David Jones and choosing your whichever sock you want to wear every day. Here is a hanging wardrobe. Now, there's many different ways that you can do a hanging wardrobe. there's two things to remember. Firstly, you want to have everything hanging from left to right. Now, the reason that we do this is every time you think about a graph, if it's going up, like if it's elevating, it feels good. It's a happy feeling. So we want to have that in our wardrobe as well. We want to be opening up our wardrobe and all the clothes are going up. That's going to make you naturally feel better. But you'll see that I've put my pink coat near my red jacket, and that's because I also love color coordination. So you just need to do what feels good for you. And there's another picture of the folded drawers. And here's an example of how much extra space you save by folding like this. Now remember, this is Japanese origami. This is created by a lady who helps people in very, very small homes in Tokyo. Now she's in San Francisco, but this is the reason we drew this, so we can use what we have and you maximize our space. So it's really gonna make a lot more space if you fold like this. Here's some examples of some organized wardrobes. You'll see that I have hung all of this client's pants at the bottom and jackets at the top. It's really, really nice to lay out your wardrobe so that it's in layers of your body. It's just an easy way to remember where things are. And see how he's got open shelving here? And we put it all in boxes so that he folded up all of his sportswear. And so it doesn't fall everywhere. See, it was falling everywhere here. It's much better like this. It feels better, it looks better. Same again, we put all the suits, all the shirts on the top. See over here, he had the shirts down the bottom. We switched it around. We folded all of the clothes and see how much more space he's got. He's got all these empty spaces up here. I find that the men's wardrobes, I always have pictures of them because my male clients, I must be just much quicker with deciding with clothes or they have less. So I don't actually have any ladies' wardrobes in here today. But I have lots of my own on social media if you want to look at that. So now that we know what we have, we've done our big declutter, we're conscious of like the resources used with all of our fabrics. Now we just need to we change the way that we buy ongoing. Now this is really easy. Like you guys all self-aware now. So the first thing you need to do whenever you're purchasing something is you really not need to know what sparks joy for you. Really listen to yourself. Again, try and avoid advertising norms if you can and just buy things that make you feel good, your own unique self. Understand when you're being sold to. And this is so common, like if we go shopping in a department store, if we're walking down the street, and, oh, this looks great. You really need to realize, or especially on like when you look browsing online, all of a sudden everything looks amazing. Really realize when you're being sold to what actually sparks joy for you. You really want to be cultivating self-awareness. So that's like understanding that we are creatures of comfort. It's very natural for us to want new things, things that make it better and easier. So that awareness as well. And become a conscious consumer. Ask yourself with every product, will it last a long time? Can it be recycled? Can it be repaired? Does it have multiple uses? Now this works for your wardrobe, probably works more for kitchen items in particular, but doesn't have multiple uses, works really well for clothing as well. You don't want to have just a jacket you can only wear with one pair of pants, something you can switch around with your wardrobe. If in doubt, go with less, always. It's always going to be the better option. Before every purchase, ask yourself, do I already have it? Now, this is a key reason why we declutter, because otherwise we don't know what we have. And so often when I'm with clients, they say, oh, I forgot I had that. Or, oh, I bought another one. I thought I lost that. So decluttering is really going to help you know what you have. So when you are out shopping or tempted to shop, you will know what you already have. Do I already have something similar? Can I borrow it? Can I buy it secondhand? Which is why this program is so amazing. You really want to be buying secondhand anytime you can. It's really important. If we're donating things and we're selling things, the only way that we can kind of keep that loop happening is if we buy them secondhand as well. That's a big one. What's it spark joy shelf life? How long is this item going to spark joy for me? Is it going to spark joy for 3 weeks? Or 3 years. If it's only going to smudge do for 3 weeks, you probably don't need it. 3 years, a lot more likely. So ask what the Spark Joy shelf life is, and can it be prepared? Be repaired. That's a big one for other items in the home, not always necessarily our clothes, but clothes, definitely it's important to repair them too. We have a whole tutorial on that with Garage Sale Trail, so make sure you do that. Here is your ethical decluttering list. So this is what you need to do once you've got all of your items that you no longer need in your home. First of all, really check with your local council. They are experts in e-waste and scrap metal and batteries and garden waste. And obviously you won't find these in your wardrobe, but I would hope that you're so motivated you'll start tidying everything. So make sure you check with your local council. If you have any questions about recycling, the Planet Heart Arc website is a great place to go. And they have some really cool decluttering myth videos that if you've got kids at home on school holidays, they're really kind of fun and they're tailored to kids as well. So I would watch them. And then on my website, I have a resources page and I have links in there for particular type of recycling. So for textile waste, for shoes, specialty charities. So you can jump on there and have a look as well. The last thing that I want to leave you with is something that for those of you who already know me, you would hear that I talk about this all the time. We are organizing for simplicity, not for perfection. If you can't fold your t-shirt so it stands up, that's okay. I really want us to be looking at everything that we have to simplify and limit our environmental impact. Fall in love with our clothes again, rather than just trying to make everything perfect. That is not what home sanctuary making is all about. Cool. So now we can take lots of questions. And just thank you so much for listening. And I really hope that you've learned a lot and that you have some big chunks of wisdom that you can share with your friends and family as well.
Sally, that was so fantastic. There's been quite an unprecedented interest in the pom-pom jacket early on.
Oh, yes.
And there's a few people very keen to maybe, if we've got time, see the folding method again. So maybe once we've had a chance to ask you a few questions, we might see if we can do that again to recap people. One of the questions I've seen pop up quite a lot from a few people is around partners. So what to do when you share a wardrobe space with somebody else, or, the great one here from Melanie, my partner says she wants to keep stuff just in case. Any tips to help me navigate this in a kind way? It's a great question.
Great question, Melanie. And my partner is the same. He has lots of just in case. The first thing to remember is that You can only declutter and organize the items that you are responsible for and that you own. The quicker we come to that realization, the happier your home is going to be. There is no point nagging your partner to get rid of their things because it really is their item. It's not your responsibility. However, it's important that we start to then talk about if it is their item, then it goes in their dedicated space. So even if they have their own wardrobe or you're sharing a wardrobe, they have the amount of space that they can have their clothes in and you have yours. And as soon as it starts creeping over, in my family, it starts creeping onto the floor, then that's the no-go zone. So the discussion is something like this. I know that I'm more organized than you and I don't expect you to organize and be as less items as I do, but this is shared space. And you really need to understand that this upsets me. So you need to work out, if you don't have enough space, you need to work out what to get rid of. And I'm happy to help you with that. Rather than, you got to get rid of it, because that's the normal reaction. And we really need to reel that back.
Yeah, great. That's going to cover off quite a lot of questions that have come through. That's obviously a very tricky thing for lots of people.
Very tricky.
We've also had a few people coming through asking questions about what you do with clothes that you want to get rid of, but you've only worn them once or twice. So you covered off some great stuff there around charities and how to donate to them responsibly. What other ideas have you got for how people can sell their clothes that they've worn once or twice?
Oh, so you are wanting to sell them? I think for clothes, there's so many options. Clothes are such a great thing to resell. I mean, you have access to the Facebook market, you have access to eBay. And there's some really awesome consignment stores popping up all over Australia. So there are also some ways that you can use that. And we have some selling resources on our website as well for ideas on how you take photos and how you sell. The only thing that I will be very aware of is trying to hand it off to a friend. So that's definitely a no-go zone. If you are trying to sell an item and you don't have the confidence, let's say it doesn't sell, I really would not encourage you to give it to a friend. You want to be having a backup plan if it doesn't sell.
Great. And the backup plan could be hosting a garage sale, right, Sally?
Exactly right. Yes, the garage sale is just, I mean, this is a real awesome way for us to kind of go through our wardrobes now and sell them, because I feel as though the easiest way, like when you're selling on a Facebook market and a consignment store, they're selling them to people who have the same like-minded thought process as you, as like they want to recycle and they want to be eco-friendly. So the garage sale is a perfect place because we're all a like-minded community.
Great question that's actually just popped up in this last second. Is there, what if they don't spark joy anymore? They spark joy, but they don't fit anymore.
Oh, that is a good question. So there are a few different ways that you can handle this one, depending on the amount of space that you have. If it sparks joy and you love it, keep it. If you like looking at it, it feels good, it's full of happy memories, that's okay, then keep it. I know that I have two dresses that I don't wear anymore and don't fit, but I keep them because I love them. I just need to be very cautious of why that you're keeping it, because you can't keep everything. I think Peter Walsh always says, if everything is sentimental, nothing is sentimental. So you really need to make sure that you're slimming down sentimental items. And the second one is that make sure you're not keeping it tanned down to someone as well. That's never a good thing. It really is your item. It's giving you joy. Honesty is good.
Great. And then one from Nikki. Nikki's asking, would you recommend a seasonal wardrobe? And if so, how would you recommend she stores stuff that's out of season?
Love a seasonal wardrobe. I know a lot of organisers aren't a fan of it. Because I've lived in small spaces, I do love them. I have a YouTube video of how to turn over your seasonal wardrobe. The key thing to remember with a seasonal wardrobe is make sure that you're putting things into storage that you love and you're looking forward to taking out and wearing the next season. So you have to make sure that it's not just a way to put things away. It's definitely you're only storing things that you love. And I'll encourage you to do it in big, like big tubs or some like big suitcases. Store them up high in your wardrobe or store them somewhere safe, out of anywhere damp in your home, and then bring it out. And it's a ceremony to kind of review what you have every year.
Great. This one I'm really liking because I have a big problem with this too. Natalie asked, how do I store handbags?
Oh yeah, handbags is good. Don't have one up here. Handbags, I like to store them, if you have a wardrobe with a hanging space, you store them above the hanging area. So they kind of sit above your hung clothes. You can store bags inside each other. That works really well. So you take like a bigger tote and you put in like your pretty evening bag so they don't fall around everywhere. You can get a box or a basket and you stand them up and slide them vertically so you see the ends of the bags, like almost like a bookshelf. You kind of stack them that way. I would definitely encourage you to store them sitting rather than hanging, because then you might get a mark in the hung of the handle.
But there's quite a few coming through actually around the left to right, just wanting a bit more of an explanation on that. There were some questions around whether that was to do with length of the garments or to do with colours, and why it was left to right that you should be organising your wardrobe.
So left to right, so left, it means that the longer ones are on the left and the shorter ones are on the right. And the reason you do that is so that when you're looking at your wardrobe, your clothes are rising from left to right. And if you think about when you look at, say, a graph or anything kind of positive, it always goes up to the left, like a shooting star. It never kind of goes that way. So this is why we do it. It's a positive way for us to look at our wardrobe. So if I was to come in and do your wardrobe with you, your wardrobe would end up being left to right in colour and in category. So I would do all three, but you don't have to do that. I like having mine in the category, so blouses and jackets and shirts, and in colour within the category in the wardrobe. It's have a play around with it. I think you need to work out what's best for you. It really depends on how your wardrobe sits in your home as well, like how you access it.
Which leads us nicely onto this good question around what if you don't have a traditional wardrobe? So this is a great question from Hannah, where she's saying she's got lots of random pieces that you can't necessarily categorize in the same area. So she's got kimonos, jackets, pants, but they're quite different. And how does she organize that categorization and start decluttering with those?
Yeah, so you'll definitely have different categories within your clothing. So there's a different, you could start to declutter by their sentimental value to you. You could categorize them by how you wear them, say work clothes, evening clothes, holiday clothes. That's another nice way to categorize them. Anything that kind of makes sense to you, I think is a good way to go. If you think that, for me, a kimono should be in the same area as a blouse. I know that I have my kimonos near my blouses, and then I have my my overalls down near where my jeans and heavier jackets are, because the fabric is heavier. So it really kind of depends on, I would definitely go with fabric and the type of time that you use them.
Great. We're going to do one more question, and then I think there's so much popular demand out there for another folding. If you're happy to do another little folding demo, we'll do that just before we wrap up. So Margaret's asked, and we've talked a bit about if you've got high quality stuff that you want to get rid of, you might want to sell that at a garage sale or online, something mm-hmm. like eBay or Gumtree. What about if it's not good enough to donate to charity? What would you recommend doing with it?
Oh, there's a few great textile recycling companies out there that you can look up online, and I have the links on my website. But also, a lot of the charities have, like Salvation Army in particular, will have associations with textile and manufacturing companies that use products, that use materials for rags, in particular cotton, not so much synthetic. So if it is, say, a T-shirt with a small hole in it, they would probably just put that in their textile recycling area. But things like really ripped, stained items that you've loved to death, undies that you've loved to death, you know, you have to put them in landfill. And this is really important that we think about whenever we purchase an item or we accept an item. Yeah, I saw someone point in there that said Man Rags. I probably didn't want to promote anyone, but yeah, Man Rags in particular is quite good. They've got a big textiling company at the moment. They did a big crowd fundraiser for that. But we need to think about whenever you take ownership of an item, you take ownership for its full life cycle. So everything in your wardrobe, you are responsible for putting that in landfill. If you're trying to just give it to the donation company because you don't have the heart to put it in the bin, you really need to realize that you are responsible for that item. And if it's not good enough to resell, thank it for its good time that you've done with it. You've loved it to death. Recycle. Sorry, bin.
Yeah, great. And as Sally mentioned there, there are actually some great organizations popping up like Man Rags, and actually H&M as well will take
donations
in store of textiles that have come to their end of their life. A great thing you can also do that we see lots of people that we meet on the trail doing is turning them into cleaning rags as well.
Yes.
So there's, you know, reusing them for what you're doing at home can be good too. We've had a question about listening again. Absolutely, we are recording today's session, and after we've done another little folding demonstration and wrapped up, we will email that around to all of you so that you can tune in. I'm wondering, Sally, whether we can do another little quick folding demo.
Yeah, was it t-shirts you wanted to think? Probably.
T-shirts, yeah. T-shirts again. I think there was some interest in socks, but I think we're...
I've got a sock here to do as well.
Right.
Okay, so with your t-shirts, face down ideally, and you see the end of the, this is like the end of the t-shirt. You want to be folding, like think of it in thirds. So you want to be folding it like that to have three pieces of fabric. So face down, you go from one edge all the way into the collar line. So you're folding into here, into the collar bit. Put the sleeve back. Take the other side of the fabric, go all the way over to the first, and it needs to match up and line up. Tuck the sleeve back in. Bottom to top, all the way to the top this time, all the way to the top. And then depending on the size of your cupboard or wardrobe, you could either fold it in half or in thirds again.
So Some great comments coming through when you were doing this initially, Sally, about this being quite meditative, and it's really got me so excited about getting home and getting Spalding.
Yes, it's such a great thing to do, and I would encourage you to try and do it straight off the clothesline too. It's a great way to do it. So socks, I mean, typically it's people tend to roll them like this, and they do tend to bounce around. You see the ugly outside, it can stretch the elastic. So in the KonMari method, we fold our socks flat, like this, and then just fold it in half and then roll quite tight, really. And then you want to be putting them in a box. Shoebox lids are the best. And then you really just tuck them all in together. And after a while, they will just sit there.
That's so good. Yeah. Do you think we could fold a sock again, just to recap for everyone?
Okay. So two socks, clean socks straight off the washing line, one sock on top of the other, fold it in half completely, and then roll. It's a tight little ball.
So good.
Here we go.
Oh, so fantastic, Sally. I have to say the folding alone makes me feel so much more kind of relaxed and liberated, and like my space is going to be so much more of a sanctuary.
Wardrobe feels so much better. It just feels lovely.
Yeah. So really fantastic. A huge, huge thank you, Sally, from all of us here at Gareth Sartrell and all the many, many people watching for such a fantastic presentation today. We've loved having you, and delighted that you could be the very first of our guests for these trail tutorials. For those of you, I'm sure all of you on the line also want to join me in saying a big thank you to Sally.
Thank you, everyone.
We will be following up. You're not alone. We'll please feel free to follow Sally on social media. On Instagram, she's at Home Sanct. And you can also sign up for Sally's newsletter to get tips from her on an ongoing basis. We'll share those details with you together with a recording and some tips for how to reuse stuff that you no longer want from your wardrobes straight after this session. Of course, there's some great events coming up that we're organising at Gareth Sartrell. So if you do get your declutter on and get your wardrobe organised, we'd love to see you host a sale on the Gareth Sartrell this year. And of course, don't forget that we've also got some other great trail tutorial presenters coming up over the next month. And that can all be booked on our website at garethsartrell.com.au. Last but not least, obviously this is our first session. We want to improve and bring you sessions that you really enjoy, that are topics you want to see covered. So we'd love you to just take 2 minutes to fill out our survey. We've gone a bit high tech with this. All you need to do is, for those of you that want, is hold up your camera phone to this QR code, and it will automatically, by magic, load the survey. We will also email it to you after the session, but we would really love to get your thoughts on the session today. So that's us, exactly an hour. A huge thank you so much to all of you for joining us and being part of our very first trail tutorial. And a massive, massive thank you to you, Sally, for a really wonderful and enlightening session. I certainly am about to rush off home and get folding and organizing in my wardrobe. I can't wait to see how much better I'm going to feel with my newly organized wardrobe.
Perfect. That's exactly what I want to hear.
So to play us out, I will just put Dolly on again. Thanks again, everyone. And we look forward to seeing you at another event soon. Bye.